When I tug the end of this thread a short distance, the spool zips towards me. And because it's on a slight incline, when I let go, it rolls away again. So just with the slightest movement, I can cause the spool to zip back and forth. How weird is that? I stumbled upon this after watching a 6-year-old physics girl video. Link in the description for that. In the video, Diana poses the question, what will happen when I pull on this cord? Will the spool roll away from me or towards me? Actually, I think the question with the more counterintuitive answer is, will the cord get longer or shorter? Because, you know, if you tug on a cord that's wrapped around a spool, you expect the cord to unspool a bit so that you have more cord. But based on the shot that I showed you at the very beginning, you may already have figured out that the spool will roll towards you and the cord will get shorter. The reason I started playing around with it for myself is because I wanted to answer 2 follow-on questions. The first one, what happens in the limit? Like, you've got this distance here, which is a measure of how much room there is left in the spool. What happens as that distance approaches zero, as the spool gets full? As a teaser, you end up with infinite mechanical advantage. And secondly, I wanted to know what happens if you go beyond that point, if you go past the spool being full, if the loose end of the cord is below the ground. But before we get into that, let's see if we can explain the counterintuitive answer to the original question. So when you pull on the rope, it gets shorter as the spool rolls towards you, and there are actually 2 ways of looking at why that happens. The first way, which is less intuitive, I would argue, is just to think about forces. So, forgetting all the detail, you've got some object, it has a pivot point here, and you're pulling it with a force from here. So, of course, the object is going to move around that pivot point in the same direction as the force. But then, of course, the pivot point moves, and so you have a rolling motion. The other way to think about it, which is a bit more intuitive for me, is to think about what happens to the rope when you roll the spool away from you. Let's roll it a quarter turn. So this is the distance the spool has traveled, and it's equal to a quarter of the circumference. Now, in doing so, we have unspooled some of the rope. How much rope have we unspooled? Well, just this amount here, which is less than the distance the spool has traveled. In other words, we haven't unspooled enough of the rope to compensate for the distance the spool has traveled. The result is that the rope is pulled from our hands. The rope is pulled away from us. That means if we do the opposite and pull the rope towards us, the spool should do the opposite as well and roll towards us. By the way, I'm assuming that there is always enough friction between the spool and the table, so the spool always rolls instead of slipping. Interestingly, if I pull the rope upwards, then the opposite happens. The rope gets longer as the spool rolls away from me. That means there must be a point somewhere in between vertical and horizontal where the spool neither rolls away nor rolls towards the pulling force. Interestingly, the angle of the rope doesn't just affect the angle that the force is applied. It also affects the point on the object the force is applied to. Like, when I'm pulling vertically upwards, the force is being applied from here, but when I'm pulling horizontally, the force is being applied down here. Look, as I change the angle of the rope, there comes a point where the direction of the force passes through the pivot point.
And if the force is passing through the pivot point, then it can't be applying a turning force around that pivot point. So that's the magic angle.
I won't go through the mathematics, but here it is on the screen. That's the angle at which the spool will neither roll towards or away. And then it's impossible to have enough friction. The spool simply slides. But what happens in the limit as the spool fills up with rope? When you've got only a tiny gap between the rope and the edge of the spool, like the spool is almost full, you really do need to worry about if there's enough friction to avoid slipping. So I'm using this high friction mat here, and I've switched to a less stretchy rope. And just like with the sewing thread, for a really short tug on the rope, the spool travels a really long way. I have some serious mechanical advantage here.
And actually, it's really easy to calculate the mechanical advantage. It's just the distance traveled by the force divided by the distance traveled by the load. In this case, it's this distance divided by this distance, which works out to be this length divided by this length, which works out to be this radius divided by itself minus this radius.
So if this radius is 1 and this radius is very nearly 1, like 0.9, then you have a mechanical advantage of 10. Actually, it's the spool that has the mechanical advantage over me, right? Because the spool has a low force over a large distance. Yeah, that's right. My hand has a mechanical disadvantage. but it means I can get something to move a long distance by applying a large force over a short distance. And brilliantly, when you fill the spool up completely, you get a singularity in the equation for mechanical advantage. Not a singularity in that sense, but a singularity in the sense of, like, in this simplified mathematical description, we get an infinity. We have infinite mechanical advantage. Obviously, you can't get that in the real world. Something has to fail. And the first thing to fail is friction. In this case, we just end up dragging the thing along. But also, when the spool is nearly full, you hardly have to tilt the rope up at all for the solution to flip and the spool to roll away. And it explains our experience with toilet roll. The spool of toilet roll is, by definition, always full. It's always being pulled from the edge of the spool, because the loose end of the toilet roll is the edge of the spool. So what happens if you carry on past the spool being full? Well, in reality, the rope itself would become the outermost part of the spool, and you'd have the toilet roll situation. But what if you could somehow keep the frame of the spool on the ground so that the rope was being pulled from under the ground? Basically, I just want to see what happens to the maths as this radius gets bigger than this radius without having to worry about real-world constraints, like the fact that rope can't pass through a table. Well, I can achieve that with this setup. So this is now the radius of the spool. The radius of the rope is greater than the radius of the spool, which is what we wanted, and it's able to pass through the table. This clear acrylic is now just there to hold the rope in place. It's not part of the spool geometry. So will the spool roll towards me or away from me when I pull on the rope? Remember the two ways of thinking about it. You can consider this to be the pivot point and the force is being applied here, or you can think about what will happen to the rope if I roll the spool one way or the other. So this time the spool rolls away from me when I pull on the rope, and the rope gets longer. Again, that makes sense from a pivot point of view. And if you think about what happens when the spool rolls towards you, well, this is how far the spool travels, and this is how much rope you're adding back to the spool. In other words, the rope is being taken away from you more quickly than the spool is coming towards you. And again, the rope is pulled away from your hands. So if you do the opposite and pull the rope towards you, you should expect the spool to do the opposite as well. It's interesting to note that in this setup, the spool will always roll to the right, regardless of the angle I choose. Whereas with this setup, there's an angle at which it flips. And that makes sense because in this setup, the force vector never passes through the pivot point. There are two other limits to consider. There's the limit as the spool tends towards being empty. And if we assume that there is no central hole in the spool, then it's just being pulled from the very center. And if we assume that the cord has no thickness, then the infinitely thin central axis of the spool will gather no cord. In that scenario, the spool would travel at exactly the same speed as the hand pulling on the cord. But what about taking this setup to the extreme? Just keep adding rope. What happens in the limit of infinite rope? Well, that's a slightly tricky thing to build, but what we're really saying is what happens in the limit as this radius becomes infinitely larger than this radius. And we can achieve that by seeing what happens as this radius tends towards zero. I 3D printed this modification to give us a very small spool radius. And what we notice is that the spool hardly moves at all. And that makes sense. Every rotation of the spool gives us loads of rope, but causes hardly any travel of the spool. I really appreciate a straightforward product pitch. Like, here's a thing you probably want to get done, but it'll take you ages to figure out how to do it. We've already figured it out. We're super efficient at it. Would you like us to do it for you? And the sponsor of this video, Incogni, fits that description perfectly. So here's what Incogni offers. There are these companies called data brokers that collect data about us and then sell that data to other companies. We don't know who they're selling to, but we can contact them and ask them to stop and delete our data. The problem is there are literally hundreds of them, and they all want to be contacted in different ways. Some want you to email, some want you to fill in a web form, some of them will reject your request and you have to figure out how to appeal. Incogni have figured out all of that stuff already, and they've automated it. So now you can sign up to Incogni, give them the right to work on your behalf, and they just get to it. And you can see the progress on the dashboard. Look, these are all the companies that now no longer have my data. And honestly, one thing I really like is that they're not constantly banging on about what they're doing for you. They'll send you a progress email once a week if you want them to, or you can just check on the dashboard. What I've noticed now is that I don't get any more of those weird phone calls from companies that I don't know, but that seem to know a lot about me. And it's just one of those things that I wanted to get done, and now it's done. If you're interested, the offer on this one is really good. The first 100 people to go to incognito.com/science and use promo code science at checkout will get 60% off. The link is also in the description, so check out Incogni today. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, don't forget to hit subscribe, and the algorithm thinks you'll enjoy this video next.